For many of the years that I lived in Boston, the springtime weeks were full of clear, sunny skies. But every single weekend provided soggy, miserable weather. What gives? Is it just my imagination that every single weekend it seems to rain? Or were the rainy days more noticeable because they were interrupting my weekend plans? Did a weather god curse the Northeast United States? Or is it some weird meteorological phenomenon? Funnily enough, it's that last thing. Weather in New England can be oddly punctual. So here's the science of the rainy weekend curse. Rain in the spring is no surprise to North Americans, with April showers bring May flowers and everything. But in 2023, 2024, and 2025, Boston, New York, and the rest of the Northeastern US were stuck with beautiful sunny work weeks and overwhelmingly rainy weekends. In both 2024 and 2025, Boston received stretches of at least 6 consecutive rainy weekends in the spring. And from January through June, there were far more weekends with rain than without. 2023 was an especially wet year, bringing record rainfall all over the Northeast. And by October, in New York and Boston, only 12 out of 42 of the year's weekends had been sunny. That's rain during 80% of weekends. At some point, you start to think that this can't just be a coincidence. So meteorologists took a deeper look at the weather patterns trapping the Northeast indoors every weekend. It's easy to forget that air is a fluid and that it has mass. We live our whole lives in it and move through it so effortlessly, yet it's constantly pressing down on us and swirling about. Air is subject to the laws of fluid dynamics. On a planetary scale, those effects can really add up. We experience these effects as weather, and meteorological events are all driven by differences in temperature and pressure throughout the atmosphere. The jet streams have an especially big impact. You might have heard your airplane's pilot mention the jet stream. It's like a river of fast-moving air that travels from west to east across the globe. But it affects way more than just your flight time. Jet streams exist because of fluid mechanics. The equator gets more sunlight than the poles do, which means the air is warmer around the Earth's middle. As the air gets warmer, it expands and rises, creating a low pressure zone. On the other hand, the cold, dense air at the poles forms a high pressure zone. Air rushes from the regions of high pressure into the regions of low pressure. On a global scale, this means that cold air from the poles floods toward the equator, and light, warm air drifts poleward above it. The cold air packets warm up at the equator, rising to replenish the low pressure zone, and the warm air packets cool down at the poles to sustain the high pressure zone. This sets up a cycle of air constantly moving from the equator to poles and back again. But don't forget, the Earth is also rotating. Air rotates with the Earth, constantly getting dragged to the east. Because of this, the rising air from the equator never actually makes it to the poles. The Earth's rotation, plus all the bumpiness of the Earth's surface, causes the circulation pattern to be split into 3 different circulation cells. From the equator to about 30 degrees north or south, we have the Hadley cells. Beyond that are the mid-latitude cells, or Forel cells. And finally, the polar cells over the north and south poles. The boundaries between 2 different cells result in jet streams. They separate regions of cold and warm air, which means the jet streams are fueled by the Earth's steady rotation and that differential warming from the sun. In particular, the northern polar jet stream is what keeps Arctic air over the Arctic, and it's strongest in the winter when temperature differences are most stark. The polar jet stream also controls most weather in the mid-latitudes of the northern hemisphere, like Boston, which sits at about 42 degrees north. Another key thing about fluids is that they're really easily perturbed. The jet stream is really just a river of air, so obstacles like a mountain range, open ocean, or just a random high pressure zone can easily disturb it and give it a little wiggle. When all these wiggles add up, the jet stream settles into a pattern called a Rossby wave that encircles the pole. Usually for the polar jet stream, this wave pattern will have about 4 to 6 dips in it. Sometimes these wiggles move north or south, and occasionally a trough might disappear or reappear all of a sudden. Meteorologists refer to the jet stream's wiggles as meandering. How cute! Maybe I should meander more. For the most part, the Rossby wave pattern is pretty stable, meaning the pattern doesn't change all that much, but it will slowly rotate around the globe. In the springtime, more intense solar radiation adds energy to the air and the ocean. Temperature differences between the Arctic and the mid-latitudes become less pronounced, which weakens the jet stream. When our air river isn't moving as fast, it's more sensitive to disturbances, so the Rossby waves can become even wavier, with the wave's troughs dipping to lower latitudes than before. This is important because storm patterns tend to follow the leading edge of these troughs. The troughs carry low pressure zones, the warmer air we talked about earlier. Air at the boundaries of these low pressure zones rushes in and flows upward. As it rises, it cools, and the water it carried condenses to form storm clouds. What this adds up to is that the Rossby waves slowly rotate around the Earth, carrying storms with them as they go. Rossby waves move at a characteristic speed that depends on how many troughs they have. This means the broad river of air slowly rotates so that the troughs change position. And that cycle takes anywhere between 5 and 10 days. See where I'm going with this? Sometimes the troughs will be spaced about 7 days apart, and sometimes that pattern will be centered on the weekends. Because once the Rossby wave takes shape and gets stuck in one of its patterns, it can be really hard to break out. Rossby waves form naturally in the jet stream based on the Earth's topography, but sometimes other climate patterns can additionally amplify or shape those wobbles and troughs. For example, persistent high pressure zones can also set up blocking patterns, like one that often gets stuck over Greenland. The low pressure troughs must deflect around the zone that's blocked, forcing a specific shape into the meandering jet stream. And that can cause the whole shebang to get stuck in a specific pattern. Hello, soggy Saturdays! Rainy weekends aren't the only consequence of these persistent anomalies in the jet stream. The jet stream also helps keep Western Europe pretty temperate, and it's what makes the Mediterranean region warm and dry for most of the year. So while Boston and New York get hit with perpetually rainy summer weekends, record-breaking heat waves and floods can get stuck over Europe. This isn't just a summertime issue either. Destabilization of the jet stream is associated with polar vortexes and Arctic blasts. During these events, pockets of Arctic air can push down from the Arctic Circle, bringing extreme cold with them. These effects are increasingly common in the US, particularly over the Midwest and Great Plains regions. Hopefully, in 2026, we won't get stuck again in these weather patterns that keep us stuck indoors. But if you live in the Northeast US, I'm sorry to say that you might need to get your vitamin D dose on your weekday lunch breaks and settle for indoor museums and umbrellas on the weekends.